Hello, everyone. My name is Jason Scott. I am the director of the DEF CON documentary.
And I'm Rachel Lovinger. I'm the co-producer of this documentary.
So what we're going to do here is we're going to do a breakdown of the creation of this thing, how we ended up with this project in our hands, how we spent basically the last year and a half putting it together, and the resulting lessons we learned from it, along with hopefully at the end, maybe a little bit of bonus footage and strange stuff that didn't get into the documentary and or in some cases doesn't exist anywhere except for in this room. So let's get started with the fun. So basically what happened was like last February, I was on a trip with Rachel in Helsinki. She was doing a presentation at a conference, and I said, okay, I'm doing some documentaries of my own. I want to go too. So we were in Helsinki, and what you see there is my smallest documentary setup, where I have a tripod and some equipment in a bag, and it is friggin' cold in Helsinki. Enough that when I wanted to interview people, they would say, yeah, you're going to come here. I'm not going outside. And so I was in the middle of it, and we get this phone call, and the phone call came from Russ Rogers of DEF CON, and through a Skype call, I talked to him, and he put forward this interesting idea, and he said, well, you know, we're coming up on the 20th DEF CON, and I said, great, and he said, and we've been thinking we want to do a documentary about it, and I can think of no finer person than yourself. And I said, and he's like, and we'll pay you. Now, I'd been an attendee at DEF CON for basically since 1999. I gave a presentation there about running textfiles.com, the website that I run. And I have progressively spoken pretty much every year since then, with a few exceptions. So I've been to many of the DEF CONs. I think I've only missed one. And I was a part of the group. I knew what it was. But I was also well aware of the rule that there are no cameras running around taking pictures of everybody and that they will be punched in the face. So the problem here was, you know, we have this wonderful event, and did I want to take on that pain? And then Russ mentioned the money again. And it was a no. And the funny part was I came up with a number of like, all right, for this I'd do it. And that was the number he offered, like on the button. And I said, okay, you obviously know me very well. So I said, I think I shall do this. Now, bearing in mind that at the time I was shooting three other documentaries. So we'll talk about how I handled that. But you know, I was busy. It wasn't like, hooray, my first documentary. So I'd made two other documentaries that people have seen, one called BBS the Documentary, which is about computerized bulletin board systems. That one took 4 years, had 205 hours of footage, ended up being 7 hours split across 8 episodes. And then GitLamp, because I thought BBS was just way too general, I made a high-definition documentary about text adventures. And I went out and interviewed people from Infocom and that history. And that one took 4 years. That had 120 hours of interviews and had gone out very well, went out in 2010. And so I had decided to do more. But I had some experience with technical documentaries and making things about computer people and getting people who weren't used to cameras to talk on the camera and so on. So I had that experience. And I had done a Kickstarter. Signed on, went for it, but there were some fundamental issues that I wanted to know about. The thing was that I knew my previous films had been about subjects that were general, like text adventures. Well, I'll just talk to people about text adventures until I have so much footage, I have a movie about it. And same thing with bulletin board systems. But this was about a finite event that happens between 4 and 5 days, depending on how you perceive it, in the middle of the summer in Las Vegas, and then never happens again. Any moment you don't film is lost forever, which is an enormous amount of pressure and completely different than how I make my films. So how the hell are we going to do that? How about the fact that everyone doesn't want to be filmed? You know, nobody wants a piece of this. You know, I mean, traditionally people have been driven away or whatever for doing sweeps, for screaming. There's been many stories of people talking. One person talked about he was running a booth and how he was talking to one of the goons, and suddenly the goon turned and said, "You will stop that." And he was like, "Who's he yelling at?" And it was somebody up in one of the skyboxes in the old Riviera, aiming down at the booth. So they were pretty strict about, let's not get with the cameras. And now we were going to say, let's film everything? So that was a bit of a nightmare to consider. And finally, how do I make this not suck? How do I make a film that's not going to look like something that G4 shit out in 3 days? How am I going to do that? How am I going to bring something special to it? How are we going to put a movie together? And originally it was, I'm going to direct this. And again, I'm in Helsinki with Rachel. And Rachel's like, I'm going to help you.
And
I know, but you know, she said, I'll help you do this and we'll approach it together from the beginning. Like, this wasn't where I got weird and then I said, what do I do? You know, from the beginning she said, oh, I want a piece of this too. And I was like, oh, really? Is this something you do? And then she reminded me that she also had a degree in film and had done films. And yeah, maybe she wants to help with this. And finally, how do you do it in 6 months? Because they wanted me to release the film on Christmas as a Christmas present to the gang. How am I going to shoot a film where we have less than that to film, edit, and put it together? So we ended up moving straight into planning, and I'm going to let Rachel describe her thought process on how she started to bring this together for this unbelievably huge project.
Okay, so there's me in Helsinki. It was very cold, as Jason said. I one of the reasons I thought I could help out with this is I actually really like planning. I really like documentaries, and I like planning things. So this is an example of a spreadsheet that I made of at my office at work. I show a documentary once a month, and we my colleague and I brainstormed the kind of documentaries that we want to show. We have a list of enough documentaries we could show once a month for like 7 years. We tracked, like, you know, which ones we've seen, what they're about, how long they are, all that kind of stuff. Just to give you an example that, you know, I like planning things.
She really likes planning things.
I've also been to DEF CON a few times before that, so I kind of had some idea what to expect. That I think was helpful. I've known Jason for a long time. So that's his senior year high school yearbook photo, and I took that photo.
Yeah. If you go back, just very quickly for this gang. So what do you pose with to show your fine times in high school? Well, your Roger Waters Radio Chaos album. If you look in the upper left, you can see my Figment cap from when they used to sell those in Epcot Center. A stolen highway flasher, a stolen payphone, just evidence thrown into my high school yearbook photo, and then, of course, holding in my hand a lineman's test set. So this is basically an evidence photo.
And a dustbuster.
Oh, and the dustbuster, because every single photo, there's 5 photos of me in the high school yearbook, and in each one I'm holding a dustbuster. Why? Because I could.
We had a very permissive high school. So the first question that we set out to tackle was, how are we going to film all of this in this constrained period of time? And of course we realized there's no way that just between the two of us we could film everything. We need to bring on some additional people to have multiple cameras in multiple places. So Jason mentioned he had this Kickstarter. He put out a call to his Kickstarter backers.
Yeah, so the Kickstarter backers thing. So here I'd made this thing called the Jason Scott Documentary 3-Pack. I'm going to make 3 documentaries. Will you fund it? And I remember that Kickstarter gave me shit at the time. They were like, you're asking for $100,000. You know, you're not going to get that. And also, you don't have any rewards under $100. And I was like, well, my counteroffer is I'm changing nothing. And we're going to put it up anyway. And it got 40 grand in 24 hours. So I knew my audience. And I have a very strong connection to this audience. They know I work hard on these films. They know why I want to make them and what I'm about. And I felt very bad that I might take on this other film. So I turned it around and said instead, guess what? You get another film for the amount of money you put in. And you're going to get some advance notice of some of the pieces in it and everything else. So I had to turn it around into, actually, this is a good thing, Plus, I get more practice, and in some ways, I get more equipment that'll help. So that was how I mitigated it. People were basically excited. Is this where I mentioned the recruitment?
Yeah.
Yeah, so what I did was, I said, I need crew. If you were supporting a Jason Scott documentary, do you want to make one with him? And a bunch of people jumped forward and said, sure, with no information. You know, yes, I will do this.
I think you basically told them, we will fly you out there and it's a shit ton of work.
I didn't even tell them that. I just told them it was a shit ton of work. I didn't make it clear we were going to pay for anything. Because I didn't want somebody treating it as a free trip to Vegas. So I just said, oh, we're going to shoot. Do you want in? And we had, I think, 8 people sign up. And I chose what ended up being, I believe, 5. And I had one person bow out because of work commitment. No hard feelings with him. And so I ended up with 4 people from my Kickstarter group who literally the way I met them in a few cases was when they flew here. Anyway, that's how we handled that.
We'll come back to them too.
Yeah, we will.
So once we knew we would have multiple people filming, we started trying to figure out, okay, what are all the things that we want to cover? So we sort of poured through the schedule. We knew we weren't going to focus so much on filming all the talks. A lot of those are filmed anyway. So we, you know, what was actually more helpful was looking through the forums where we got information about all of the parties and the contests and the events and the unofficial as well as the official events and where they were going to be and when they were starting, and that was incredibly useful.
Anybody who uses DEF CON or goes to DEF CON, I'm sure you know this, right, is there's just places you go to and there's places you walk by and you hear someone say, I'm doing an Easter egg contest, and you're like, well, good for you, and you don't do it, or you go, shit, yeah. And there's so many people for whom DEF CON is a very limited experience, and so we suddenly had to become the omniscient awareness pack of all aspects of DEF CON 20, everything from, like, how do they set up the rooms through to every event that was even peripherally being planned in the forums, because some of them are very, very liquid in the beginning. Like, I'm thinking of doing a thing, and I think I got someone tell me it was okay, and we're like, well, got to get him on the list. All right, guy with thing, you may be a movie star soon. So that was a very strange experience to pull that much together.
So we pulled that all together into this, again, a spreadsheet, and we captured, you know, what things were happening, when and where they were going to be, and tried to sort of sketch out what are the things that we think we want to film about this event to sort of, in order to tell that story. And some of these are going to be things that are going to be happening all weekend, so, you know, we know, like, okay, we want to be there when Jeff explains what the tamper evident contest is.
Yeah, this thing is a fantastic document. So this is Rachel's work. And part of her professional job is constructing data in a way that makes sense and understanding the underlying pieces of it. And she's very good at it. And so we had a real gift here, because if you look at it, there's a color coding to indicate, will we get in trouble if this is not filmed, down to if the camera swings across it, everything's good. And then followed by, what's the narrative? What do we think the narrative is? Like, what's the narrative of the toxic barbecue? What do we think the story that needs to be told about a speaker is? And then followed by, who do we think are the players in the story? Do we know who the organizers are? Do we know who the big people are? And then finally, notes where I write, I don't understand anything, and everything else on the side. And this goes on, this we only have one slide, but it goes on for like a dozen pages at least. It's a huge, massive document.
And there's also, you know, it highlighted things that we didn't know, and then we would, you know, reach out to Pyro or reach out to Russ or ask people, okay, what's going on with this? Is the beard contest happening this week, et cetera?
Yeah, and so that's how we found out things like the Cannonball Run wasn't happening. And other times we would, like, get surprised and find out that something was happening that we didn't know. But we were really, this was our secret weapon. You know, one of the secret weapons is this, like, where is the work? It's like, well, here it was. Here was months of screaming work trying to track down who's this, who's this, who's this, and what is it. So we had, if you want to say, the Bible that DEF CON doesn't have as to what DEF CON is as a reference document. The Encyclopedia of DEF CON.
So that got us about, about as prepared as we could about the events. The next question we tried to tackle is how are we going to film everyone, film an audience of people that doesn't necessarily want to be filmed or hasn't traditionally want to be filmed. And we went through a number of ideas. I think one thing, we had an idea at one point to like give out paper masks.
Yeah, we were going to give out paper. We proposed things. One of them was maybe a paper mask with, at the point, anonymous, or another one that people could hold up when the cameras went by. And the response from the goons was, no fucking way are you going to give 15,000 people masks.
So instead, we decided just to make ourselves really identifiable and that anyone would be able to see us coming and could get out of the way or kind of indicate they weren't interested. So our first idea was we'd get everyone orange jumpsuits. And then we quickly realized that...
103 degrees plus jumpsuits equals we have three crew members at the end.
Yeah, and everyone running around all day in these, we didn't want to kill the volunteers. So we went instead with these nice light mesh orange vests. Well, Jason will show off for you. They have lots of nice pockets in them for carrying things, and we spray painted the logo and the word documentary on them. So there would be no question that, you know, who we were. And the side benefit of this was that we were really easy to spot by each other. So if we were like, we're looking for one of our crew members, we could always find them. And you'll see them throughout the film, actually.
To this day, I will see people in these and go like, I wonder what they're filming.
And then we entered the real official pre-production stage. So... I want to call out here to Russ Rogers. Right. Jason mentioned Russ called him, but he was also really our like primary liaison. So Russ and Dark Tangent were our co-executive producers, but Russ was the guy, like our day-to-day contact if we needed anything from the conference, if we had any questions beforehand while we were here. He was our guy.
Yeah. Russ and I talked. When all was said and done, I think Russ and I talked for roughly... between 100 and 200 hours over the past 18 months, just over time. I mean, he was there every time to give me heads up, to tell me something's going on, to get back to me on every aspect. I mean, he this isn't something where it says executive producer and that means they wrote the check. It's literally this guy was working on it equally as hard as me, especially some months, especially as we started to move towards where is this thing going to end up and how are we going to publish it. He was right there. So he's not here right now, I don't think, but believe me, he was as critical as any other component, this guy.
So then we had our crew, so we want to introduce you to them. These are the six guys and then Jason and myself. These are actually the photos that we sent to the goons, the security goons. So in addition to having our vests, they wanted to make sure that they knew what all of our crew looked like, and so nobody could impersonate
us. So there wouldn't be the documentary crew within 6 hours of the documentary crew being there, running around roughshod.
I don't think anyone tried to impersonate us, though.
No.
That I know of.
No, we were not. I don't believe anybody actually impersonated us. We were confused with people once because, and somebody with an orange shirt was kind of a dick. And somebody was like, the documentary crew is harassing me. And it was like, no, they don't have the time to harass anybody. And I mentioned this to one of the goons, and they said, welcome to our world and everyone who has a red shirt.
So we actually, I looked back on it, we gave them shockingly little preparation for what they were going to experience at DEF CON, especially considering most of them had never been to DEF CON, and now we're asking them to cover everything about it. One thing we did ask them was to watch Morgan Spurlock's Comic-Con documentary had recently come out, and not for the same topics exactly, but not even the same story arc, but we knew like this was a good example of what it's like to try to capture on film an event with massive amounts of people and tons of things going on at once. So we said, watch that and you'll have a little sense of what you're in for. And then aside from that, we just wanted them to be comfortable and safe.
Yeah. And I do say, I had met Morgan Spurlock at a conference, and so we recognized each other, and then he was at a presentation of Comic-Con Episode 4, and we went there. And so I watched it like, oh, somebody did sort of the same thing I want to do. And we watched it, and afterwards his two producers and himself were there, and I actually asked them a lot of way too technical questions personally, like when they were just chatting, not Q&A, and I have a question, please teach me how to film. But you know, I did get some hints from him and what they were shooting for, and they did open my mind. They came up with some ideas that they never had work, and I just want to mention one because it was kind of brilliant. He wanted to, so they do a more story arc thing than I would ever do, where they would actually went out, they got 20, they had applicants send in a recording of, I'm going to be at a Comic-Con and here is my story. And then they chose like the 8 or 9 most compelling stories and then sent crews, and then they ended up using 4 of them or 3 of them. And what they wanted to do, if you know of Comic-Con, it's got this massive, you know, many, many thousands of square feet.
It's like 3 floor. Football fields
yeah,
long.
Yeah, massive thing. He wanted a Super Bowl cam, and what he wanted to do was, as a transition, you would be following someone's story, they would walk out on the floor, and a camera would pile back from them and zoom down Comic-Con's floor and then follow the next person as a transition. And when he got there, they were like, no. No, there's no line of sight anywhere in the Comic-Con floor that does that.
He could have done that with drones, I bet.
Yes, that's exactly the next thing they want, is helicopter drones flying over people. Nope, with massive banners, so it just looks like Star Wars Episode 4 trench scene.
Nice.
But anyway, so he was thinking out of the box, too, of like, how do I make this exciting? And it was very inspiring. So thanks, Morgan.
We also had, in our pocket one ringer, which was one of the people on our crew, Eddie Codell. He is a professional as well, and he's done a lot of work with Boing Boing TV and MakerBot TV, and he's filmed at Comic-Con and at South by Southwest. So he's kind of familiar with being dropped into these kind of crazy situations and right. being able to handle it. So
we wanted to know we had a clutch just in case it got really hot. Because there were so many unknowns. We were like, we want to know we can send a guy in who has filmed these things, who's going to hold the camera steady, who's going to follow what's going on, and we don't have to worry. So if we really need footage and we're scared and everyone's falling apart, we know Eddie will at least barrel through. And so that was just us just taking a little precaution for the good. And I insisted he be paid at close to his regular rate and treated like this was a perfect, not hey, buddy. Come in and do hard work for free because DEF CON.
I think we still made him sleep on the floor.
Though. Yeah, we did. Yeah, a little tired. Eddie is here.
All right, so let's. Why don't you tell them about the equipment?
Yeah, so you know, where are you going to go about when you're putting this thing together? And you know, a lot of people when they see a movie, there's a certain range of people whose their response is, well, now tell me exactly every last piece of equipment you use to make this film, because that's kind of what we all like to do. I know a number of filmmakers who also make geek documentaries, and after I got my Kickstarter money, I sat down with them. Paul of Two Player Productions, who are the ones doing the Double Fine documentary right now, but they've also done Mojang, the story of Minecraft. They've also done the 8-bit movie about chiptune artists. And I also have become really good friends with James Swirsky and Lisanne Pajot, who are the creators of Indie Game, the movie. And I just basically did a con call with James and Paul and said, your camera, what is it? And they tell me, your sound, what was it? How did you get this shot? What lens did you buy? And so I shopping list. And I bought everything they had. So I had some really good stuff like the Canons and I had some really good lenses and everything else. Now, just to explain what we're going about here. So the problem was that the best camera to shoot with is the Canon 5D Mark II. I don't mean in life. I'm not going to play that fucking game. I hate that game. But it's the camera I found would produce really good footage under a certain circumstance. But the body is like 4,000 and then the lenses are thousands. And so I had one because I got them for my movie. But I knew that we were going to have 3 crews, and I couldn't be giving away 3 Canon 5Ds. Plus, they're really weird to work with. And so we settled on something called a Vixia, which I'll show you more of in a moment. And so we basically had, Rachel had a Canon. I had a Canon 5D. I had a 5D. And then we had 3 Vixias. And then we also, this was one of our ideas, was let's get little play sports. And so what you see there in the center, there's an orange one and two black ones, was let's get play sports and give them to people at the con and get other footage and see what comes of that, with the hope that we would get something utterly disgusting. Something horrifying where there would be a moment where you were like, is it more of a crime that it can be seen and not just vaguely remembered and drank away? Is it terrible? And we didn't know, and of course we figured they'd come back and they would have been destroyed, or someone would never come back with them, or whatever, but we got 11 of them, just in case. And they were very cheap. We got them on special. They were under $100. They're waterproof. They shoot in high definition. They can take shock and dust. They're just tough little bastards. And we figured, okay, this one will they'll survive, and we'll see how much footage we get from them. So that was like our little secret sauce wild card, because as opposed to the documentary crew runs in. Obviously, we'll still respect people, and we wanted shots that were evocative and people might have, but we didn't want to lose crew for like 6 hours if somebody went on a road trip.
And this this lets us be in places where we would never know to be, if we give them out to people. We gave them to, like, some goons, some longtime attendees, and, like, some of the people that we, that were competing in, like, the scavenger hunt and some of the other contests where we just couldn't be with them all the time.
Right. And so we ended up with, a bunch of these cameras and obviously the lenses and other pieces. And it was all going to be filmed on digital. There's no analog in here. There's no videotape in here. There's no anything like that. And we also have Zoom H4n recorders, which are my favorite recorders. They're little guys. They're really tough as well. And you could do recording with them in all sorts of circumstances. And they go right to MP3. Let's look at the next one. Here's the setup that we ended up going for, or a variation of it. And what this is this is me at another convention. This is me at a comic book grouping in New York City to test this. I just ran around with it filming. And we have a monopod sitting on these little Canon Vixia G10s that also film high definition. And here I've got an extended microphone, and I'm storing the item in my pocket. We ended up just getting rid of and slimming down and getting rid of the external microphone and using the internal microphone and just having our guys put the microphone right here and try not to get in the shot. And that actually worked out spectacularly well. So what you see there is a setup that is infinitely portable, is really fast to set up, can get anywhere, takes really good shots, and can deal with the action in just a really, really intense way. So it turned out to be a really nice combination. We had three of these going at any given time. Is there another one? I think there's another footage. Good.
Oh.
Okay. So with that, we kind of said, okay, well, Or I should really say Rachel said, we should have a presence online. Let's get people excited. Isn't that what you do with a campaign? Let's build up here's what's going on. Let's make a Facebook group. Let's do a Twitter stream. Let's let people know what's going on and build a YouTube channel. Let's build a presence for the DEF CON documentary in anticipation. And there's a very interesting thing about that, which is that nobody gives a shit about DEF CON until like a month before. Like, a few people do, a few insiders do, but on the general, nobody's like, better check the Twitter stream, better check the Twitter stream. They don't start getting excited until right before. And we had a lot of conflict internally between us about this because she's like, we should treat this well. And I'm like, but nobody's giving a shit. And we're not getting responses, and I'd rather focus on this and this. And so we had a lot of conflict, and it just turns out, for anybody who's doing anything like this again, or any kind of a deal, it's just DEF CON is something that people put a lot of energy on, but they put a lot of energy either on their projects or they put a lot of energy towards learning about it in anticipation, like a few weeks before, to get more info. So it's better to like backload your stuff and have it ready to go and start dropping hints like a week or two before or 3 weeks before. Work on it, do your projects, but they don't really start paying attention to like day by day reloading what's going on until just before. That was a hard won lesson. We wasted a little bit of energy on that.
All right. I think so. Then we get to production.
Right. I think I do production too.
Here you go.
Huh. How do you capture the spirit of DEF CON, past and present, says the slide. So my concern was this, like in capturing DEF CON, because like I said, first of all, no G4 crap. Second of all, I wasn't overly interested in doing what I was going to call Sparky Goes to DEF CON story, right? Where I find some kid, it's his first DEF CON, I go to his house, find out his mom and dad are still married, and then he likes computers and he has one in his house, and then he's going to go to DEF CON where he will be found naked floating down with the bubble stopping sometime on the second day. I just wasn't interested in that narrative, right? And it forces the, I mean, it's a perfectly valid narrative, right, to do that and do a story that way, but I didn't think I wanted to do that. I wasn't comfortable with that. What I wanted to do was have authoritative voices in a mosaic discussing what DEF CON means to them, and then the best we can illustrate all of that in the material over the course of the next, you know, the course of the movie. And there was another mystery factor, and I know the joke, which was, what if DEF CON gets canceled? And it was, you know, and it could be, there's ways to be canceled without being canceled, right? I mean, hotel gets smoke bombed. There's a problem. Because of something, there's nobody able to attend the talks in the same way. They run into a security issue. There might not be a DEF CON to film. And that would be an interesting story, right? DEF CON, da-da-da, DEF CON is canceled. And then just credits. Organ music. A 17-minute movie. And a dun-dun-dun-dun-dun. And so I was worried. And so I front-loaded with as many interviews as I could handle, especially of staff that I knew would be balls to the wall. So what you're seeing here is one of my setups. This is in a hotel at Hope. And Hope really appreciated that I was filming a DEF CON documentary at Hope. I was like, yeah, I'm filming some people for a DEF CON documentary. I was able to do one thing. We were able to fly in Dead Addict because he lives in Toronto, and I wanted to be able to film him, but I didn't want to go to Toronto to film him, so I brought him to New York. So for the first time, one of four people who have been to every DEF CON got to go to Hope for the first time because he never got a chance to go before. So that was kind of nice. And we're filming in the hotel room I got for him, so it was a reuse. And I filmed interviews with Dual Core and Deviant Olam and Dead Addict at Hope and was able to use this kind of a setup. And this is my setup. So you can see my Canon. You can see how I use a boom mic. And then I like to use halogen lights and really flood the room with light and bounce it off. And I mean, this is a shitty hotel room, let's be clear. The Hotel Pennsylvania is one of the worst pieces of property in an urban area outside of a firebombing or World War II. But I was able to get some mileage out of moving it.
If you've seen The Shining, it feels a lot like...
It feels exactly like The Shining. Shining plus ass rape. Anyway, so... All right, move... Yeah, so like, here's me filming Jeff, and this is, like, kind of how I would do this. So here's me. I'm filming him, aiming it at his desk. This is one of only two locations we could use. The other one was truly unusable. This one had an echo. But I filmed him randomly. And so I went to Seattle, I went to Los Angeles, I went to Colorado, Denver area, and I went to a couple of houses in California and a couple houses on the East Coast and Washington, D.C. And, you know, basically did about 50 interviews with people that made it into the movie in some cases didn't get into the movie. And so they're all filmed under different circumstances. Hacker spaces like Den Hack and 23 and Black Lodge up in Seattle, you know, they opened up their spaces to me and then would have their members come over, and one by one I'd interview them and just do these interviews and try to do my best to make them all interesting locations. And you know, by the time I was done, before DEF CON, before minute one of DEF CON had started, I had roughly, I want to say, between 30 and 40 hours of DEF CON footage about DEF CON and senior staff explaining why DEF CON meant things to them, what it was about and everything. So I knew I wouldn't have to track those people down. And then there were people who used to be part of DEF CON and are never going back again or rarely go back, like Death Vegetable and Swamp Rat and other people. I wanted their voices in this thing, even though I knew they weren't attending. So this was part of the hard work. It took me about 60 days to get flown around and do these interviews. So I knew coming in I was preloaded. So if it all blew up, I could have all of this and then say, ironically, it never happened.
But
the thing is that the first documentary I did, BBS documentary, has a lot of talking heads. And yeah, they're weaved well, and I worked really hard on it, but it is talking heads. And the same thing with GitLamp, a lot of talking heads and then a lot of illustrations of games. And I knew that I wanted this film to be kinetic. I wanted it that you were seeing things happen, that there was motion, that DEF CON is a thing of motion and activity and throngs and people moving around. And so I resolved that even though I had 30 or 40 hours of people sitting telling you DEF CON is awesome, I couldn't see by Saturday, it is fantastic, I wanted that you would see somebody blind drunk on Saturday or see that people were working hard or soldering. And so that was on my list to make sure that it would have that feeling.
All right. So, and we,
yep.
So that was all in the lead up time to DEF CON. And then finally last July, we assembled our whole crew at DEF CON. There we are.
Yeah, that's a pretty... I love that shot.
With our fearless leader.
Fearless leader and Wendy Lady and the Lost Boys. And
yes.
And this is us all assembling. We all have our outfits. We are an army. And I just love this shot. So it's everywhere because it just really captures it. Oh, yeah. What's up with the fucking segue, Jason? So I've been known for having a segue in previous years because I like segues. And I discovered or I realized that we were going to have situations where we'd be over here in track three and then something would happen in Penn and Teller and I'd have to go there. And so I'm like, I'm going to get a segue so I can get from one to the other really quickly. Because we don't know if we were going to get radios and we weren't know if we were going to get communication. So the segue became the catch-all solution.
Okay. So we got here. We checked all our equipment. We had a couple hotel rooms. One of them became our sort of HQ, our production HQ. And we made sure everything was there, made sure it was all working. Before the conference started, we took our crew around. We did like a walkthrough of the space to show them where everything was going to be. And we had them take the equipment with them and kind of, test it out and get comfortable with it and, you know, be able to ask some questions and stuff like that. So we did a whole walkthrough of this area. I think that was really helpful. We did like a sort of a boot camp, but, you know, mostly it was just to, again, make sure that we're going to be safe and comfortable and bring the footage back to us each day and that sort of thing. The conference lent us a bunch of things, some walkie-talkies, which ended up being a little... you don't really want to keep walkie-talkies on while you're filming because you don't want someone suddenly like...
Do we even know where room four is?
Yeah, that can kind of screw up the footage. So these ended up being of limited use to us, mostly just because we didn't want it screwing up our shots.
I seem to have some vague memory of us doing something really enjoyable with those radios, like some sort of message. And I'm now forgetting. I don't know if
we
remember.
Yeah, we mostly used them to prank each other.
Yeah, we were just fucking with each other. So we ended up like, does anyone even know where Kyle is? Kyle here.
They also...
You don't need to find me.
They lent us a printer and, of course, the hotel rooms.
Yeah, the hotel
like
rooms came from DEF CON himself, not even in the budget, and that was really appreciated. We had a couple hotel rooms. I think we had three.
Yeah.
Three hotel rooms to put our staff in and have us the thing.
So we went out and bought some supplies. We, you know, got a lot of water and caffeine and food and post-it notes and things like that. And this is how I learned that if you go to two different pharmacies or drugstores in Las Vegas and spend about $100 at each one, sometimes your bank turns off your credit card for no good reason. That was awkward. Then we had our production meetings in the HQ every day, our room. And this is where, so, you know, we had our big list of all the things that were going on, and we had assembled our crew into three pairs of two people. So we'd have one person, and we actually figured this out during the boot camp, sort of like who liked using the camera, who liked doing audio. We figured out who was a morning person, who was a night person, and we kind of paired them up, like we paired up morning people together, and we had three groups of one cameraman and one audio recorder, and we...
Colors.
Yes, we nicknamed them Team Red, Green, and Blue. And each, you know, when we knew what things needed to be filmed each day, we wanted to make sure, like, you know, is this something you're going to be interested in? So that we would kind of go through, okay, here are the things that are happening tomorrow. Who wants to film this? Mm-hmm. And then we would make up these shot lists for each day, so they knew, like, okay, at 10 o'clock, this is happening and where it's happening. And then we had a bunch of things that were like, you know, at some point, go by the, you know, Hardware Hacking Village and that sort of thing. So there are things that happen at a certain time and things that were just happening all day, but they all had their lists. And then we had, like, the master list on the wall, which we had every event that was going on up there. And by the end of the day, we'd kind of check off all the ones that we had gotten coverage of, and if we had ones that hadn't gotten covered but they were continuing the next day, we'd just move those over to the next day.
Yeah, we had Team Red, Team Green, Team Blue. We renamed Red Team Breaking Bald, so that's what their name became after a while, because it was two bald guys. And we paired up our least experienced member with our most experienced member. So it was Alex, who had not been in Vegas, been to DEF CON, or done any shooting, up with Eddie, who had done all of that, with the idea being that it would balance out to a reasonably talented person. And actually, you know, I mean, obviously, like everything else, you know, Alex learned really quickly, and Eddie worked with Alex, and it went pretty well. And then the other teams, they really worked well. Team Breaking Bald turned out to be a real gift, because these guys were getting up at 8, and they would go to bed at 2 or 3 over and over. And Steve on that team, the camera guy, would just film endless establishing shots of everything. So if you picked up the groceries, he would film the bag, you grabbing the groceries, you holding the groceries, the groceries, the groceries in the fridge, the house the fridge is in, the sun, and the town, and then the factory the fridge was manufactured in. And that was a real gift to me down the line, because I would have someone talk in the editing room, and I'd be like, do I have a shot? Of course I have a shot of that. Because there was just shots of room, shots of people, shots of stuff. So each team started to take on a character of what they wanted to do. And it just kind of organically, that part was organic. But as you can see, thanks to Rachel's planning, there was a lot that was not organic. Like, I'm a real improviser. I don't come in with preformed questions for interviews. And yet here, you know, it was like, what is everyone doing? And we knew. As opposed to, you should just walk out again and shoot things and come back. So that's, you know, just for people who see this movie, I'm fractally pulling out here, but I'm just saying, when people see this movie and they see the stuff, they're like, wow, they really, it's because she did this amazing matrix of all these items of stuff so that we were always aware of what we needed. And that's the real secret hard work that's not obvious on the screen. It's not just, oh, they filmed until they made a movie. It's like, that's what was really there. So, unfortunately, yes, there is no secret get movie quick scheme.
So we also, another part of our HQ, this was sort of like our information hub. We, every time the guys dropped off their cards, their memory cards, we copied them onto multiple hard drives to make sure we had many copies of it and nothing would get lost.
Yeah, we had 3 hard drives. Every piece of footage went on 3 hard drives. And then when we got it home, we put them in 6 hard drives in 3 locations to verify that we would never lose the footage due to a hard drive going south. And just to understand like how much space these things have, the cameras, the Vixias, had 2 32 gig cards in them. And they could record 25 hours of high-definition video without having to be swapped out. And the audio could do 36 hours of full audio before having to be swapped out. So even though we did it every day, we didn't have situations where people were like, I'm out of film. So we really, really over-engineered that part. That part turned out to be really good.
All right, then we finally started filming.
You know, the gang was set out on this really strange journey, right? These guys were put out into this thing. For some of them, they'd never been to Vegas before. For some of them, they'd never been to DEF CON before. And it is really strange to experience DEF CON in God mode, where you have essentially carte blanche to walk into anything. It was a really bizarre experience for me, especially because I'd been there. But for the others, they hadn't even been there. So it was like, you know, try to imagine you walk into a room and people are talking and you're like, well, I think I'll just go on stage. Yeah, this needs me. And I'm going to go sit behind this person and film the back of their head because I feel like it. And then that guy, oh, he's interesting. He's leaving. I'll follow him like a creeper until he goes into the hallway. And it's this thing. Oh, the goon security center. Oh, sure, let's hop in there. Let's go talk to them. Ah, what the hell? And so that was like a massive emotional thing for me. But for the others, it was like, okay, I guess I'm going to film this part. They were able to film inside and outside. Here's an example of unused footage. We filmed Scotland at the Toxic Barbecue. But you can see here how the setup might be, where they would set up the camera, they're listening to what's going on, and then they're talking to Scotland about the Toxic Barbecue. And so these little setups were everywhere. For me, I ran into an additional bonus, which was I started filming from the Segway. What this did was, this afforded me crane shots to give me the kinetic energy that I wanted in the shots. And the film is loaded with these. These are post-processed, stabilized crane shots shot all over. And I'm wearing a hat because I tried to make myself even more obvious. Like, I see a weird cowboy hat and bright orange and what the hell? Oh, God, it's the camera guy. Looking back, I probably should have also had a Steadicam Merlin, which was a weight-balanced thing, but I didn't do that. I would just be driving along and literally go like this, go around people, and then keep going. And that Segway gave me enormous ability. There's a scene you'll see in the movie where it goes around the speaker party on the roof, and you see me just zooming through people like I'm on some sort of weird rails, like right by people's heads. And I only ran over one person the whole con, which was really amazing. I was really surprised, only once, and it was his fault because he was sitting on the front row with his feet like way, way, way out, and it was dark. And I flew over and he yelled and I gave him a red card and kept going. And don't touch my Segway. And anyway, that turned out to be besides being a good transport mechanism, it turned out to be a really good filming mechanism. So it really added to the film. I guess I'll mention here, I believe in tone poems, which is where you look at pieces of work and say, well, why do I feel this when I look at it? How do I create this? And how do I get that feel? And for me, believe it or not, a lot of the tone poem for the movie for me comes from action scenes in Sherlock Holmes 2, Game of Shadows. And if you watch that film, you watch the forest scene, if you watch the fight at the end, a lot of the kinetic sense of that movie, I wanted this to have. And so I use that as a template, like kind of a rough feeling of like what would feel like to go through DEF CON, this thing. So the segue helped a lot. The crew went everywhere and they weren't afraid to go everywhere. And in a lot of different shots, you will see them because one crew will catch another by mistake because they're moving around so much. So you can see here just all these different cases where they're filming, and this is in many cases these are screenshots from other team members catching other team members on the way. And, you know, I watched Great Improvement. I keep making the joke about Kyle because in the beginning Kyle's like, could you please, would it be possible to interview you to talk about the DEF CON documentary? And I'd like to understand you working on this. And by Saturday, he's like, yo, sup, what's this thing? And people just being, yes, I'm working on this thing. And so by the end, they are like an unstoppable information gathering force, like a news program on steroids, just slamming through this place to get all the info. Sometimes just miracles of like stepping in and getting a perfect shot of this event happening, like perfectly framed, beautiful.
So Jason mentioned like we had some team that was more in the morning and some more in the evening, but really everybody was shooting Like, we were working from 8 o'clock in the morning until sometimes 2 o'clock in the morning. Then we would go back to the room and have our, you know, debrief and production and planning for the next day. So I think we got probably roughly like 3 or 4 hours of sleep a night.
Right. And one of the things I mean, I was very strong about treating the crew with as much respect as possible. So, again, we paid for the flights in, so nobody's putting any money in. And I insisted that we go on a really nice dinner the night before DEF CON started. So we went to the Italian place here to talk more, but just mostly to let them have whatever they want on the menu, because I knew they were going to get terrible sleep and terrible eating, and I wanted them to have a memory of at least, oh yeah, Las Vegas was kind of fun once, while they're stuck on the ground trying to get this one shot of somebody talking. I was happy once. I'll be happy again. So I, you know, because again, this is the first time I have people working for me in this capacity, and I can do whatever I want to myself. You know, I used to do, I had filmed things where I'd go 1,000 miles in 4 days. And that's fine. There's only one guy getting punched in the face from that. But I am punching people in the face by doing this. And I wanted them to know I respected them as people. They're not just for hire machines that I can run into the ground and then drop back in the recycling bin when I'm done.
They worked very hard.
Yeah. Really hard. This is my lovely Alex. Falling asleep during an interview. And it's very adorable because if you listen to the footage, they're like, do we wake him? Nah, just keep talking. Again, this was Alex's first time in Las Vegas, and Alex is 18. And so he would finish a day at 2 a.m. and then go back out again. So that's what you do when you're 18, because why not? And so it wrecked him a few times, but he yeah, great foot. You know, he definitely has work to show for it. Beautiful work. It's just, it was rough on him. So yeah, this is one of my favorite shots of him. You just want to hug him. And so, you know, we had a lot of really impressive response and places that we were going. This is from the DEF CON Kids sequence. And the crew would always make sure to get like some really nicely framed interviews and do interviews like I had done. To seamlessly fit them in and record them under all sorts of circumstances. So what you're, you know, what would happen is it wasn't just here's some people talking and here's a shot of a key and here's a shot of a room door. It was also sitting down and interviewing them straight up with the same approach that I was trying to get them to of like, why are you here? What does DEF CON mean to you? What's a funny story? And so here are like these kids, they're explaining what work they're doing on the badge. And so there's a lot of stories that are not just mine. I would estimate something like 70 to 100 interviews that came back from the footage. And of course, we really liked shooting outside. I didn't think it needed to be. And you know, this was funny because this is one where Kyle got lost, I believe, right?
No.
Was it the other one?
No, it was. He didn't get lost going there. He got lost when they arrived back here and he was trying to find the parking lot. And going around Las Vegas was the problem.
Right. He took a wrong turn with the rental car and showed up like an hour and a half later with the haunted face of a Vietnam vet. And I was prepared to let him have the rest of the day off. Like, I was like, if he comes back and he's let him rest and we'll just work with what we have.
No, but then he turned around and he went with us to the toxic barbecue.
Boom, grabbed it, went right out like it was nothing after the initial haunting. And just fucking took it. And so, you know, we got all these wonderful shots. I really wanted, and Rachel really wanted to capture these events that were on the periphery of DEF CON and not just make it about this beige room has these people. And I also knew for us attendees, many of us never go to the toxic barbecue. Many of us never go to the shoot. So what does that thing look like? And so this kind of footage to me was a real gift and why the movie starts with them. Because otherwise you would never know, you know, that this was happening. This is interesting because what you're seeing here is you're seeing General Alexander and Jeff walking, but what you're really seeing is a new cameraman, Steve Fish, learning how to do the walk and talk and the West Wing Adam Sorkin shot where he started just walking backwards through many different hallways with people clearing the way while the two of these guys, well, these two guys talked about DEF CON. And I had no use for this in the main movie, but I made it the beginning of the preview because in it, Jeff is basically, General Alexander says, "What's up with the guys? Is this like crew? Do you have like news crews?" And he's like, "No, this is our people." And he proceeds to explain to General Alexander, who would be number one on the list of people who would not give a shit about this, the nature of the DEF CON documentary and why the DEF CON documentary was made and what the planning was and why they're doing it. So I made that the introduction of the preview because I just thought it was hilarious that he's like, "So, General Alexander, while you're off doing whatever you do, here's why we made the DEF CON documentary, and the DEF CON documentary is going to be an explanation." And it was crazy. And the whole time, Steve is walking backwards, filming people. You know, it's a Stanley Kubrick one take masterpiece of not getting hit with anything. So it's crazy. And so
I would say it probably helped that General Alexander's like Secret Service people were screaming, you know, "Get clear the hall, clear the hall."
Yeah, that was working out well.
They weren't doing that for us.
Yeah, not for us.
But
they should have been. You know. When you see the interviews that are done with the DEF CON logo behind them, here's Wins. What would happen is that in our hotel room, this is our hotel headquarters again, I moved the couch, stole a DEF CON banner, hung it up behind it with basically my light gear and a microphone stand and a chair, and then swung it behind them. And these are like kind of the more pro, quote unquote, you know, like, "Oh, here's a thing behind me and I'm talking about this, so that's why it's here." And I conducted most of these on the Monday afterwards. These were people like Wynn and Dan Kaminsky and others who had been there and I hadn't had a chance to interview them otherwise, and they sat. Dan Kaminsky moved the flight to be interviewed. You know, I was able to get a whole bunch more interviews. So in the movie, you'll see a lot of these with the DEF CON logo. This is the setup that I would use. And what I would do is I would be interviewing a person on there, no notes, no anything, and then interviewing the person through a whole bunch of questions. And so a bunch of people sat this way. And this was how we were able to get a few more, quote unquote, pro interviews without too much trouble. I also filmed over in one of the rooms here. And if you listen on the soundtrack, you can hear DEF CON just kind of like floating in the background. This is just the sound, the thrushing sound of people and things. And I had to do enormous amounts of sound editing, which I'll go on afterwards. But this is kind of the setup from the side.
It was always fun when like Russ would see me and be like, "Where's Jason? I have Miss Kitty. She's ready to interview right now." And then we had to find you.
He'll find me. And I was also just kind of walking up to people and going, "Hey, want to be interviewed?" And many people would say yes, and many would say no, and I would drag them off and interview them. So it was like completely random like that. And I did that. I was doing that through a lot of it. That was how I was spending my day. And again, people were pulling out play sports that we had given them in all sorts of different locations. So we were getting little tiny bonus feet. Now, with the exception of the scav hunt, who produced about 20 hours of it, we had most people produce between 3 and 7 minutes. Because they're in friggin' DEF CON. They don't want to film it. So they're shooting their thing and they're doing a collection of little shots and fucking with things and doing stuff and then being done with it. So there wasn't a whole lot to go through at the end, but there were people actually using these and they were very usable. So it actually turned out to be a pretty good gamble for what it was. There was a couple times that we would film people and then they would sober up and they would find us and be like, "You can't put that in there." The most common thing was people would idly say to their bosses, "And I'm in a documentary." And their boss would say, "And you're not." Sometimes they were government employees. Sometimes they, got the fear of God in them and thought they had said something stupid or incriminating. And so they would come and find us. And I think we would delete it. We would bodily delete the files. Because to be honest, like 99.9% of the people had no problem with us filming, right? So you can't be like, "Well, how dare you? We filmed it. It's ours now." You know? I mean, I wanted to respect these people. I didn't want anyone to regret being in our film. Or at least minimize it. And one way to minimize it was to respect people who were like, no, I don't want to be in this, it turns out, or I'm not comfortable with it.
That only happened a few times.
It only happened a few times. I only had a couple people who I'd sit down interviewed who said, can you not put in any part where I discuss this subject? I've decided that's not a good idea. And I said, okay, fine. I don't like playing that game of you said this was okay and now we own the footage and we're going to use it. I mean, you're making the wrong movie. You are making movies wrong as far as I'm concerned in general if you're doing that. If you have to be that, you know, don't act like you're friggin' exposing some underground orchid ring, you know? Don't act like you're like friggin' morally safer and you've just caught people out. That's not the movie I want to make. So minimal deletion happened, but it did happen. One of the ways you should never don't do this. I was interviewing some drunk people, and drunk people are funny. And I said, and they were going to give me the postmortem of how they won or lost the Hacker Jeopardy, and so they are toasted, right? They're supersized drunk, right? And so I said it would be funnier to do it in the bathroom. It got weird. So what happened here is that basically, and there's footage of this, right? Because it's on. And I go, all right, let's go into the bathroom and let's do this. So we go in and there's the casino host who had been using the bathroom, who came out and said, no. This didn't make it into the movie. But I will always remember, it's not the guy with the white pants, but the one next to him, he's a little obscured here. The camera comes around, they're lined up to present, and the guy looks over and goes, oh, what the fuck? Like, just that exasperation, goddamn, a camera crew, I am pissing. Anyway. Didn't make it into the movie. Don't go into a bathroom. The only other time we weren't really allowed to film was because at one point we unwittingly, I swear to God, unwittingly, we wandered up, one of the crews wandered up in the beginning behind some goons who were talking. Like, never approach a goon from the back. And the goons turned around and said, whoa, you can't be filming us with, no. You know, and so we made sure from that point to literally approach them from the front or to film from a distance and not to record them. Because if they're working and they're busy and they're making decisions and they're discussing it and what do we do with this? You know, even at the screening last night, there was a goon incident, but you didn't hear it, right? Which was somebody decided, well, he was drunk. All right, fine. That's already base level. But he decided he didn't need to go all the way to the bathroom. And so he just pissed himself, pissed the area, and fell off his chair asleep. Thanks for the free beer, Jeff. And a goon had to get up and quietly go over there during this movie while the goons are talking about how hard their job is and roll this drunk and get him out of there. So you don't hear about that. Great place. So the goons are always working like this. They're working on things you don't have to see, and so they ask that we not have their internal discussions. Otherwise, it was free and clear. Free and clear. Best quote of the whole thing was we had this happen. And so I'm not going to tell you how they were, but we said, okay, we won't shoot this. the best moment for me will always be where I was shooting, you can see me here, shooting behind RenderMan. And RenderMan uses this slide, which is the Kaminsky problem. I'm always put up across Dan Kaminsky, so I never see his talks, and it's really silly. And he wants to see my talks. I never get to see them live. He doesn't get to see my live. That is the exact moment I realize Kaminsky's on stage somewhere. And Dan Kaminsky, for his bit, is a rather famed speaker. And I considered RenderMan a classic DEF CON speaker, but so is Kaminsky. And I realized that I had aimed all of my team towards RenderMan's talk and had nobody assigned to Kaminsky's talk, which I was not aware of where it was being held. So, and I said last night, this is like the kind of dream sequence. You do this in your dreams. Is I'm standing behind somebody at his presentation. He mentions something. I'm like, I must be there now. And I run off the stage onto my Segway, onto my winged beast, and fly through DEF CON at like 20 miles an hour, like as fast as the thing goes. And I pass Eddie, and I'm like, Eddie, go to Penn and Teller and film Kaminsky. And I fly further, and I think I hit Drew somewhere up there. I was like, Drew, also, see if you can film Kaminsky in Penn and Teller. And I zoom into the Penn and Teller space. Kaminsky has packed Penn and Teller, and there are 100 people, 40 minutes or 20 minutes into his own talk, waiting to maybe get into Kaminsky's speech. That's how, for some places, their job requirement is you must see Kaminsky's speech live. I zoom past them like it's nothing. See ya, bitches! Go through the doors, the double Dutch doors, where there's Kaminsky's speech in the Penn and Teller room. Drop my Segway, run down the center aisle, and jump on stage and get behind Kaminsky and start filming him as if it was no thing. And nobody shot me. I could just do this. Truly God mode. I just wall hacked DEF CON and ended up behind him. And there's a really funny tweet from somebody going, what the fuck is up with the cowboy? Like somebody is on, like watching this up from their room and they saw the shot with Kaminsky and they're like, what's up with the cowboy? And then later, lol, Jason Scott. So that was one of my things. Otherwise, this would have never happened. And we ended up using both of them and putting them together in the movie, and we got all these great shots because we had that reactiveness. Eddie came in, started filming, and I actually zoomed back and forth a couple times to get both and get as much as I could of the footage and the goodbyes and the everything else. So it was purely luck and that he even mentioned Kaminsky at all. Otherwise, we would have missed it. Weird moment.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
So our crew, after we finished, we sort of debriefed and found that, you know, they had all been asked a lot of the same questions over and over and over again as they were doing this. So some of those questions were pretty straightforward. A lot of these things up here we've either already answered or will answer by the time we get to the end of this presentation. There were some that were a little bit more out there, so I wanted talk about those for a minute. So the first one, you know, people really wanted to know when we wanted to film them, if I agree to be in this, you know, am I going to end up feeling embarrassed for being in this movie? This
yeah, get rid
is
of the, it.
Yeah, hard to look at, sorry. So, you know, the answer there is, of course, like as Jason was talking about, we did not set out to intentionally embarrass anyone. This is not a kind of movie of like, look at the weird hackers or that kind of thing. So we also know that there's a lot of crazy shit that goes on at DEF CON, and we wanted to capture that, but everybody who was doing stuff like what you saw on this slide, you know, they knew what they were getting themselves into. We made sure of that. People who were here last year, they had these badges. People wanted to know what our badge was, because one of the parts of the aspect of the badge challenge was you could take the human badge and hold it up next to another badge, and they would kind of communicate with each other. And they had an aspect of the challenge was to communicate it with all of the different kinds of badges. So we had a press badge, which was a little bit rare, I guess, to find. And so people wanted to scan them. And at first, we found this was a little bit disruptive, like we couldn't get down the hall once people started doing it. And then we realized, well, we could just interview these people. So when people would come up and ask to scan the badge, we'd say, all right, you can scan it, but then, you know, talk to us about what you're doing here at DEF CON. And that worked out pretty nicely. This one was a little weird. We got a lot of people asking us for help. And they would ask directions. They would ask us about the schedule. Somebody came up to me during one of the talks and said, a guy has popped his knee and he needs a wheelchair. And I was like, I'm filming a documentary. I'm in no position to do that. And so, you know, we would point them towards the goons or towards other people that we thought we could actually help them. It was a little weird. And the only reason I could think is because, like, we had these orange vests and sometimes we had the walkie-talkies and we looked like authority figures. But it's strange to me at DEF CON where people seem pretty conscious of that. They would just be like, walkie-talkie, authority figure. Like, this guy is wearing silk pajamas, for Christ's sake. Like, this is not someone you, you know, should be putting all your faith in. Speaking of those vests, there was a lot of interest in them. Not too many people wanted a Rufius, but people did want...
Everybody wanted the Rufius.
Well, yeah. They wanted to know, oh, where can I get one of those vests? And, you know, like, as I mentioned at the beginning, these vests were custom made for this. We just made them for our crew. But, of course, you can order orange vests anywhere. But this was a one-time thing. A lot of friendly people at DEF CON offered our crew drinks at all times of day. Most of the time we were like, oh, we're working, thanks. No, thank you. Well, you know, maybe later. Sometimes towards the end of the night we were known to accept a beer or cocktail or, in this case, a swig of homemade absinthe. But
Two words that need to go together.
Yes. So it was very, very friendly, and I guess we're lucky that nobody roofied us and took our vests.
No, there's a great shot. There's a great footage. I had to watch every second of footage. So there's one footage with Eddie that I love, which is someone's like, "Jason, I have no choice." Hand comes out, beer leaves, goes behind camera. I'm sorry, Jason.
It all worked out. A lot of people suggested we should make this documentary every year. No comment. But in the end, we didn't break anything. We didn't lose any of our equipment. We didn't lose any of our footage. We didn't get in too much trouble. I think it was a success. After we were done, we took our crew out to relax in Las Vegas for a couple days, like a day and a half.
They got a day. They got about a day after that. We basically said, we have no requirement for you for Monday. And so I'd made sure the rooms were booked from Monday to Tuesday morning and that they would fly out on Tuesday so they could have a day of their own. They did go-karting and went out to eat and went to places, and we went to Peppermill and, you know, just generally, like, got to see, you know, Vegas. Because, again, for a couple of them, this was it. This was their first time in Vegas. So we took them to the Encore and Peppermill, and I took them over to Luxor just to see it and everything else. Just so you could actually see, get your head up out of DEF CON, and there's actually a Vegas here. So... just all a little right. gift. We're at 180.
Okay.
Just so you know.
Wow.
Here, so
you can do this.
So just as a thing, we're going to go through this. We're going to show a little bit of footage at the end, but if you have places to go, totally understood, and we'll do this until they kick us out of the room. But anyway, so editing and finalizing. So now suddenly I ended up with all this footage. Now, how do you put it all together? At one point, Rachel said, "How are you making the plot of this?" And I'm like, "Here's how you do it," and this is literally what I drew in the restaurant. And this was my plan. And she was not happy. But the way that I approach these things is pretty straightforward. I tend to take all the footage and I watch all the footage and then I put clips out. I go like, you know, render man, colon, I don't get nervous before I speak. And it'll be like, that's what it's described. And there'll be another one going like, shot, walking from here to here. Or it'll be like, guy starts to get angry but then realizes who we are, or things like that. So there'll be like shots and things, and I start to put them into a classification. And I start building up these little sequences where I'm like, here's a bunch of people talking about there's lots of drinking at DEF CON, or speeches are hard to put together, or I'm here to meet people, or these people are my family. And I start assembling them in great amounts. And then eventually it starts getting to the point that I end up like trying to put together like-minded shots over these sequences to illustrate things until finally this is actually what the final piece looks like before I printed it. And so as you can see, there's well over 2,000 or 3,000 cuts in the movie. This is what took me. It took me 2.5 months to go through the ultimate. It was 278 hours of footage. I went through that and produced from it 6,000 clips. The 6,000 clips then I probably used probably 1,500 of them. And then those 1,500 had something like 3,000 edits done to them. In many cases, I fix what people are saying. I take away ums and ahs. I remove weird sounds. We've had a lot of progression software-wise, so I could remove clangs or phone rings, or in a couple cases, unintended air conditioning sounds. I would only do this at the end, you know, just to remove the air conditioning sounds so you couldn't hear what the person was saying over it. And then steadying the shots and removing line noise, or I should say video noise, so that they looked better. And I was very pleased. I got one sequence done, and we were like, okay, there's going to be a movie here. And that was the speaker sequence with Renderman and Kaminsky. We were like, yep, there's a movie here. They were shot with all different footage. It all works. There's no question. We have a movie here, and I was very happy. So that was months and months and months and months of work. I put the final touch on the final thing for this thing on July 3rd. So I was editing. I took a month off, you know, and I would come back to it and stuff. I estimate I've probably seen the full movie about 170 times. So, I mean, I've seen this movie. I can just sit here. I do this with a lot of my movies. I can just sit in the back just kind of mouthing everything everyone is saying and then anticipating it because I just know it by heart. And there's a syndrome that I call, which is overfamiliarity syndrome. I'll shoot somebody dancing and then I'll live with it for months. And when I see the guy at this, I'll be like, buddy, who the fuck is this guy and why is he acting like we're lovers? And the answer is because I've been looking at your lovely face for 3 months like some sort of errant creepy fan. So how do you get it in for Christmas? You don't. Got up to Christmas and we're like, ah, fuck, no way. And it was a big stress because he was like, I made a promise. So we compromised and made a 20-minute version. And I put that out. But ultimately the movie did take... I mean, considering that the movie was more footage than I'd ever dealt with before, and the previous ones were like over a year of editing, the fact that I was able to edit it in about 9 months is crazy and an enormous amount of work. You know, well over 1,000-something hours of editing and fixing and refining and finding things and dealing with it. There was surprisingly little editorial control executed upon me by Jeff, who had written the check for this and for paying me. Jeff's check paid all... I took a flat fee up front. That paid all of my credit cards off and paid off my car. And so I was debt-free, which is the biggest gift in this world. And so I was debt-free. And I that made a huge difference in my life. So for me, the amount of work done was irrelevant because my life was so much better. And so he didn't... There was one part that mentioned a specific number of how much something cost. They asked that go out because it could cause contract problems to be publicizing that. There was one sequence he asked to be taken down from 2 minutes and 30 seconds, and I returned with a sequence that was 2 minutes and 30 seconds, so that didn't work. And there was like a couple other shots where they're like, does it have to be this shot? Can it be this? And I said, fine. It's like really no, honestly, for the fact that he completely paid for it, pretty much none, zero. So that went really well. It ended up being available here. I had nothing to do with how they put it together, and I'm really amazed at what they came up with. So you can download the whole movie for free. The torrent is either up now or will be up today at media.defcon.org. And they have I wanted it on a USB stick. There was debates almost up to a few months ago of it being on Blu-ray. And I'm like, Blu-ray is not the way things get happen now. It's USB stick. Make it a downloadable thing. And so they created this crazy deluxe lunchbox hard drive thing without telling me. And it's amazing. And they thought they were only, I'll say this amount. They thought they were only ever going to sell 50. And they sold 50 the first day on pre-order. It was like, yeah. People love this friggin' thing. So I'm really happy that it's gotten that beautiful amount of reception. Conclusions. It's hard. Doubly hard. This is them literally recording me asleep. Bastards. Segway turned out to be a really good idea. Throw a segue into the mix. Alex will always get in a shot. See in the corner there? Alex will always get in a shot.
No, to be fair, I think Alex was just so excited to be here.
Alex was
he
really
got a little swept up in the...
He got a little... So what would happen is a couple times something would be going on, he'd like get right in it. And he's so adorable, but he's everywhere. And, you know, we didn't ever look at this thing as something we had to finish. Like, oh, we're going to film people. Let's film people and that's a movie. We're done here. You know, we never sat down and said... You know, okay, we're going to make it as, you know, we'll film it and we'll be done with a movie. I wanted a movie that changed people's perceptions of DEF CON or changed their own love of DEF CON to something even stronger or encourage people to understand how magical this thing is and how it happens, right? And I gave a year of my life to get that story out. And that was what we tried to do. And this is our crew getting their bows during the closing ceremonies for one moment and then running back into their places to keep filming.
I think some of them were filming still while we were on stage.
Yeah, still filming. They left it going and everything else. So that is the main part of our talk. Let me just let's swap.
Yeah, they don't
so we're gonna sneak this and until they kick us out. Let me just quickly. Okay. So, all right. Oh wow.
Yes. Yeah,
so, oh wow. So I won't be able to do that. That's amazing.
No, here.
Do it.
They're all in. Nope, not that.
All right.
Wait, here.
This is exciting. Do this. You drive. I'll point.
All right. Which one do you want me to start with?
All right. Let's do this.
It's like karaoke.
I know. It's exactly like karaoke. Click on extra bits. That one on the right. All right. So let me show you an example of something that's wonderful and beautiful, and I didn't use it. It would be top left, the first one.
It's actually been really awesome. I've met who've been going before me. I've met a lot of other really interesting, awesome people. I'd go to dinner with somebody and find out later that, you know, it was somebody extremely important that I had no idea. They just forgot to mention or something. But sorry, I'm getting a little excited.
So like there's somebody who, what he's saying is I found a place where I belong and people respect and trust me. And it's a beautiful moment, and I didn't put it in the end because I had all these other beautiful moments, and I had which beautiful moment is going to get screwed without turning this movie even longer? It happened all the time. Let's skip that one. Let's go to the third one. This is the kind of great stuff.
Anyway, so what happened was...
Motherfuckers!
And so show up and fuck it all up.
Motherfuckers!
That basically...
You know, we would always get those kind of helpful responses. Let's go with second to the bottom on the left. I have to hear every second footage, and I would hear things like this.
Closes, it's not nearly as conspicuous. So you have access to keep on shooting. So as soon as we're done with this interview, I'm going to need to go into the restroom, but I can wait until we're done. I don't want to miss this. So.
So you're telling Jason Scott that you need to take a dump?
Yeah, pretty much.
All right.
Red dump.
You know, and you have to listen because you don't know what you're gonna miss.
That was the red crew.
Yeah. Upper right. You know, here's a case of me taking some footage I didn't expect, and I decided to do something with it. A very special moment. Let's do the professional thing. Remember, he says some of the most emotional, meaningful things.
Sorry, I don't know what's happening.
Nuts.
That's great. Go ahead, do it. Now. Do it. Bring it on.
You turn it up if you can.
It's dead to me.
Just read your phone into the
He looked at his phone to see his notes on how he was going to do an answer.
We're making it right there.
And we just destroy him.
We have the same phone.
Oh, my. Oh, this part here, I made the most friends when I was working the scavenger hunt. This
Death
was
Con is sorry. Very important to me. I
scavenger hunt
about
changed my life.
Sorry, I'm tweeting. Sorry, I'm tweeting.
Are you tweeting that the Deaf God documentary crew is making fun of you?
I'm tweeting.
Demetri.
Come to 874 for verbal abuse.
Demetri.
Or is that Jason's
Scandinavian hunt charged my lig.
Penis.
Penis. Heart.
Well, I was going to tell you some things that you may not realize.
All right, well, bring it up to me.
All right.
Bring it up.
Great. Are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready.
Let's fucking do this.
I am so ready. I want you to think of this interview as a scrotum that you fucking Hiroken, and just fucking nail it.
I'm just going to scratch it gently then.
Bring it on.
All right. So...
Grab the left nut of this story
and just tug.
Just tug it.
Gently, let's not
do it.
Let's not get hurt. Okay. fucking balls.
Go ahead. Shh,
we're trying to be professionals here. Damn, professionals, we're fucking professionals. Hi. All right. So
what's great about that is if you see the movie, you're like, "Oh, what wonder, that's what came just before it." Before he talks about it.
He came out with some great stuff right now.
Beautiful stuff. Here's footage that, there's a time lapse where somebody goes from Los Angeles to Las Vegas. It's the bottom one. It's the bottom one, yeah.
It's the sunset.
Yeah, do it. And so basically what happened was Windows Media Players decided it does not love you or care about you.
Wait, this one.
So what happened here was that basically I ended up with this beautiful time lapse. And then I had this other one here where somebody sent me a beautiful time lapse of the sundown at the Rio. It's flickering because it just completely made my shit flip out. It was like 3 gigs of JPEGs. And I tried to stuff them in the thing. And I could have fixed it a little bit, but after a while I said, this was going to be like Friday night, now whatever. And it was going to go down. So it's this absolutely beautiful footage that I just never got a chance to use. All right, knock that one out. We'll switch over. This was the greatest thing that ever happened in the entire world. Just click on it. Third one up on the right. Here's the deal. Nope, not that one. Just pull this one up. Boom. Okay, so here's the deal with this guy. In the original footage, they're shooting, and you can hear one of the other team members go, "Get that guy." Which guy? That guy. That guy. And they turn, and there's this guy. All right? Now, I don't know this guy. I don't know him. We never know who he was. Bless this man. So we're shooting party footage and we're shooting this guy. Now, this guy, he's a little bit, he's a little height weight, non-ratio bound. He's dancing, and he's listening to this music. And he is dancing. And he doesn't stop. And now most people would be in this situation would go, "Okay, I got my shit done," and then like walk or calm down, leave. You can see the other people in the back, the guy in the back left there, he's looking at him, he's a little wiry stick, and he's like, yeah, right? And then this happened. And he is back. And if you look down at the crawler, we're nowhere near done. I mean, this guy just keeps on going. So whenever we would have flagging energy on any of the teams, it'd be like 2 a.m. and it'd be like, "I don't know if we can put your fucking hands up," and we'd like run back into the crowd and do more filming. And just for the rest of the whole weekend, "Put your fucking hands up!"
Yep, that was our rallying
cry. There's like 1 second or 2 seconds of him dancing in the Saturday night sequence as a tribute to him. So we have no idea who this guy is. We'll hear from him, but he is incredible. And I know he's probably at his desk right now looking at this thing in December, going by on the videos going, "Oh, fuck. Oh, no." All right. Let me see. Let's do underwater just because it has a great line from Rachel. We were testing the underwater ability.
So we mentioned that these cameras, the little placeboards, we were supposedly able to go underwater, but we weren't positive.
I didn't change the moon.
Totally fucking a mooner, right? Got everything sealed in place inside. Sides.
Scrotum real.
Yeah, exactly.
Those are some of our crew.
Let's do it. Go for it.
If it didn't work, we're not telling Jason how this happened.
Okay.
Oh, shit, I recorded that.
And that's the shot I used in the credits with him clapping his hands. But the sound here is beautiful.
All right, here we go. He'll only know if it works.
Record up here and then dunk it while it's recording and see how well
it's recording right now.
Oh, okay, go for it.
It didn't turn off.
So guess what? Those play sports are actually pretty awesome. Yeah. So we actually were able to put a few in there. Did we fix the crash? The crash footage? Good. This is a PDP crash.
What would happen? What sort of terrible creature would be born from this unholy union of man and machine? Mental computer and mental computers creating a new race.
Yeah, I indicate this was some sort of mating dance.
A young man establishing for himself.
It was late. That's one of, we definitely found time to pop out. Why don't we go up out? Let's go into one of the bonus things. Bonus. So these are bonus features. This is all on the USB sticks. So all these pieces here.
The ones you just saw were not. But
yeah, the other ones there, those are ones that are not in the thing. Let me see if there's one that really kind of captures the, a lot of these are meant to be, varying states of informative, and I have very long things on CDC and things on the hacking for charity, things that were important stories. And then there's
Santa.
Yeah, I know you're like porn Santa, but let's make him the last thing. Wait. Okay, so down one and to the right, there you go. Then there's this story saved for all time.
All right, so we had went to the New York to that terrible Asian restaurant they have in there, that terrible Chinese joint, and I had Mongolian beef, and then we went back and threw the party in the room, and so I got a little bit too drunk, shall we say, and at the end of the night, as everybody was, as the party rolled down, I ended up in my bathroom, in my bedroom, and I just lost all of it. Just it looked like somebody grabbed a big old plate of Mongolian beef and just threw it around the entire bathroom, and it was awful. I mean, while it looked like it was just normal Mongolian beef, of course it didn't smell that way. So, we wake up the next morning, and I'm intending to clean it up, but everyone's like, let's go get breakfast, we'll clean it up after. So as we're rolling back to the hotel, and we're walking up to the hotel room, and this poor maid, the look on her face was awful. She walks out of the room, and she looks at us because she knows we have the hotel room. She's like, someone in there go blah. It's so bad, I go blah. We made the maid at DEF CON vomit. I feel so bad for this poor lady. I think we handed her $60 or something as a tip. I just apologized. And that's the Mongolian beef story right there in a nutshell.
The air conditioning in the room is
hot. Oh, right? Yes.
And I came up to offer you water because you've been thrown up.
Oh, yeah.
And he's sitting naked in his bathroom.
Yes.
And I'm like, you want some water? Fuck you. No, you want
some
fuck me.
Oh, yeah. The AC had frozen and the smell was awful and I was just sweating bullets. Naked, laying in a pile of my own vomit on the floor. Yeah, that's woo, yeah, that's a high moment.
You were gonna let me walk out of here without that golden footage. You were just gonna be like, I had a good time and I threw some parties. DEF CON was good. For some reason, I stopped going. Goodbye. Congratulations on 20 years, Jeff. I support you. Very good.
What's the only thing that happened?
What I love about that is at that moment you can hear there's 12 other people in the room because I'm going through this whole crowd and they're all trying to stay as quiet as possible while he tells this disgusting story, and then they just lose it as soon as I start talking. Let's do the upper right one, top quality production. You're like, you need a blooper reel, right? All right, blooper reel.
One of the things that, I don't know.
Quality production.
I look forward to seeing this in the film.
Yeah, seeing that exact thing in the film.
Yes.
Yeah, but are there principles at all? Jesus balls.
I told you, it's the quiet one.
It's the quiet one.
Watch. It's
the Metrolink.
It's the quiet ones that always kill people, though.
Oh, that's the Chicago train. Have fun in Chicago on Wednesday. Not that I know anything about the train going back here. Busted!
What? We're contemplating the perfect fucking shot.
Whatever. You know what?
Perfect.
Get back to work
shot.
Or we'll throw you
I
out.
I don't want to be on camera. You...
Not creepy at all. Good shot here of the room and, you know, us putting things together and doing stuff. And then, you know what this needs? This needs a close-up. It's also...
It really feels like definitely...
Wow. Well then.
Blew out the transformer.
But everything's on batteries, so it's still recording.
I have one fucking light.
I'm a nice guy, but I'm not a nice guy. And I'm just like, shut up. It's not my... You can hear giggling. That's Russ giggling in the darkness.
I just didn't want you to break your cord.
No, that is awesome. You know what the best part is? I have that completely on camera.
Yep.
Holy balls.
I use balls a lot. Do we... Okay, so... Oh, yeah, Porn Santa. The epic story. The epic story of Porn Santa.
I gotta go hit my contest.
podcast. I hope that was good for you.
The epic journey of porn Santa. People are now coming in. I think it's respectful to like clear the room for the next crowd. So again, thanks so much. If anyone has like a burning question, I'll answer it right now. If there is, anyone have a burning question? They're like, what you did? The screening is tonight at 8 o'clock in track 3, I believe.
It's the track
that Hacker Jeopardy is not happening in, but it's at 8 o'clock tonight. And we'll screen the whole movie and even answer some questions afterwards and maybe play a little other bonus footage if people are still up for it and have a good time. Was it worth it? Of course it was worth it. It was a wonderful time. Rachel and I had a lot of fights over many things and a lot of screaming about getting this and that done. But I think at the end, the product speaks for itself. And I think that we have a really special piece of work. And without, you know, Kyle and Drew and Alex and Rick.
Can we get them to come up here?
Yeah.
Some of our crew members,
just come on up and say hi. Just come up and wave. You can do it. You're smart people. Stage. Get on the stage or we won't be able to see you. So, yeah. So here's our gang. Lovely Alex. And so... So here's our gang who are here. And Drew was here yesterday for the premiere, but he had to go back to Hawaii where he lives now. And Rick is busy in Florida. But it was out without these people, without Alex and Rick and Drew and Kyle and everyone else. We wouldn't have it. We wouldn't have this movie. No way. So thank you so much. Do you want to say anything, Rachel?
Nope.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much for sitting through.